Welcome to the Jazz Flyte Podcast. I'm your host, Darrell Scott, and together we will dive into the lives and careers of the jazz legends who have left a rhythmic imprint on the world. Be prepared to reminisce on the highs and the lows of their musical journey and the trials that sculpted their timeless musical gems. We'll preserve the legacy of these extraordinary maestros and find inspiration in the melodies of their lives. Subscribe now and never miss a beat. Now, let's get to the show. Welcome to the Jazz Flyte Podcast. I am Darrell Scott. I am sitting here with a gentleman who's a Grammy winner. He's been nominated for Dove Awards, Stellar Awards, a thousand Grammys. And with all of that, he is just a great guy. He really is. This is a conversation. We have a certain amount of time, but this is something I hope we can carry over and just do this in person and just have conversations. Because folks, you would love just to hear this guy talk. You would. He's got some great ideas, some great thoughts, and doing a whole bunch of things. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Kirk Whalum to the Jazz Flyte Podcast. Kirk, how you doing?
Thank you, Brother Darrell. And you know what? That that backdrop there is very humbling. You know, I'm very grateful for that. And, you know, it takes me back, you know, some serious dues paid, man. And, you know, you come into this space with all kinds of expectations that are built out of summer, everything, man,
right.
You know, sand, you know, like, and when you now, you know, where we are now at 66, you know, and with, you know, a lot of, as they say, you know, most of it is behind me now.
Right.
I really do. I treasure it all. I mean, even the parts that were really, really hard. And there were a lot of those. You
know? Yeah, I am sure. And speaking of your beginnings, let's talk about your beginnings. Born in Memphis, moved to Houston. At some point, you gravitate to Los Angeles. Each one of those has its own sound, we'll call it. The Memphis sound, the Houston sound. And there are many great people, great musicians from each city. How do you, especially starting out, how do you take that Memphis sound and mix it to the Houston sound and then move it all to Los Angeles? What are you doing?
Yeah, and by the way, I mentioned that, you know, speaking of Los Angeles musicians, man, Plas Johnson is one of, well, I'll just say, when people ask me, what's your favorite recorded solo on the saxophone? And I'm sure they wait for me to say, you know, Charlie Parker or whatever, but I say Plas Johnson on the song by Marvin Gaye called If I Should Die Tonight. And so I mention that because, man, L.A. has its own legacy of great musicians, people whose parents were born in L.A.
Right.
You know, and, you know, people who migrated out there, you know, that book, The Warmth of Other Suns by Wilkerson, you know, it's kind of the story of our migration as black people from Alabama, from Mississippi, Tennessee, Louisiana, you know, to various places. And the ones who went out west, primarily from Louisiana, but some from other places, and you want to have some real authentic gumbo, go to Oakland, California.
Let's not talk about gumbo.
Right.
I love gumbo. I love it.
My wife, man. My wife is dangerous, man. My father taught my wife how to make gumbo.
Yeah.
And she took it and, like, sort of incorporated all kinds of other authentic elements into it. It's African food, man, and people don't even know the word gumbo means okra, you know, like that's it's all part of what we do,
right.
Like as jazz musicians, you know, the gumbo of what it is that you know, you hear when you hear a Kirk Whalum, you know, a Norman Brown, you know, Jonathan Butler, when you hear us, you're hearing a gumbo of all these different inspirations and influences, you know, is far as, you know, Western classical music or to Brazil, you know, Sergio Mendes, we just lost, you know.
Right.
I mean, I devoured his music, you know, and all these other things. That's what it is. It's a gumbo.
How do you have these people that you respect and that you listen to and that are kind of, you know, they're your mentors. Mm-hmm. How do you then encompass that into your sound? What do you take? What do you use to create now the Kirk Whalum sound?
Well, I think a lot of it is subliminal. You know, I don't think you purposely do this or that. I mean, there are exceptions. Like on the new record, Epic Cool, I have a song called Crusade Oration.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a direct in your face, you know, this is me tipping my hat and bowing to the great Crusaders from Texas Southern University,
right,
where I went to school. And but that part of what we bring, the part that you mentioned about, you know, this amalgamation of all these other influences, you know, no, you have to try to do you. I think, you know, you come up with what you feels natural, you know, mm-hmm. and feels comfortable. Try to stretch yourself in this direction or another, but still bring you. And in that, those other things are going to show up, man. You know, you grow up in Memphis, the gospel and the blues and the R&B are going to show up in mm-hmm. your music, you know, unless you were hearing impaired growing up, you know.
Okay.
And, you know, and then to get to Houston, man, I was four blocks from Arnett Cobb's house when I was there on campus, you know, staying in the dorm at Texas Southern. And he would come visit us and just break off some wisdom, man, and knowledge, you know. And hearing him play, I could just hear it all, you know, the pathos, you know, of this man's life and music. So it absorbs into what you're doing. And so, man, at any point, you can hear it if you have the ears to hear it. Like if you go, oh no, I know Arnett Cobb, I know Illinois Zach Cat, I can hear
right
a Texas tenor. I know a Texas tenor when I'm hearing one. You know, not everybody knows that information.
Right.
Yeah.
Man. See, this is what I'm talking about. We're just two guys just talking. who were your, obviously Arnett Cobb. Is there anybody else who was a mentor to you or somebody that you listened to and you know, wanted to pick the apples from their cherry tree, from their apple tree?
Yeah. So Arnett was the main one because I had access to him. You know, the two guys that I listened to in high school were Wilton Felder and Ronnie Laws.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, broaden that out to Spiral Gyra and David Sanborn and, of course, Grover Washington, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the more I got into college, I got into the serious study of jazz mm-hmm. at Texas Southern. So that's when I got into, you know, Coleman Hawkins and, you know, Dexter Gordon and Sonny Stitt, who I did end up meeting. And I met Sonny Rollins and I met Dexter as well. But so those influences all, you know, kind of factor in to one degree or another. But the primary, I'll say this, man. A huge influence on me was the drummer / bass player / saxophonist in my father's church, Olivet Baptist Church in Memphis. His name was Ozzie Smith. Ozzie is now a recently retired pastor. So he and I kind of were on similar paths, you know, mm-hmm. music theology. But he was the first guy who sat me down and showed me the progressions in jazz, you know, harmonic progressions, 2-5-1 and all that thing, the building blocks of improvisation and composition. We're right there in the choir stand, you know, at rehearsal, and he's showing me these things. And so to this day, I lift him up, Ozzie Smith. A lot of people in the Chicago area be like, oh yeah, he pastored Covenant, you know, Baptist, United Church of Christ. And that brother's deep, man, both theologically and musically. But that was the guy who sat with me and tutored me.
Okay, so I'm not going to follow my list of questions because you just made something come to my mind. You at some point decided to do, I'll call them the Gospel According to Jazz CDs. You did four of them.
Yes.
What was the inspiration behind that? Because as I'm growing up, and don't get me wrong, we're the same age. Actually, I'm 1 year older than you, as I had a birthday a couple of days ago.
Happy birthday, brother.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it. So What made you go that route? Because the other stuff is just tremendous. I think you could have stayed with, we'll call it the contemporary jazz stuff, but you decided to venture out on to this gospel thing. Why did you do that?
Well, I love Jesus. We'll start there. And I've always seen myself as a minister of the gospel in one way or another, like however he will have me. So I was using my gifts and my area to try to bring him glory. But what happened? As they say, what ha happened was
Right.
I have a TED talk, a TEDx talk on this subject that I always say that Columbia Records did me one of the biggest favors ever. When they dropped me from the label, man, I was just, in fact, the thing, yeah, that album you have back there, the LP, was on Columbia, and I thought, you've arrived, you're on Columbia, man,
Right, exactly.
and Miles Davis, and man, when they dropped me, man, it just gutted me, man. I didn't know what to do with myself because in my head, I thought that was who I was. I thought this is my identity. Now, who am I? My wife caught me that day, man. And she's like, godly wife, you can't have a better presence in your life, man. And she said, okay, what can you do today that you couldn't do yesterday when you thought you were a Columbia recording artist? And I was, okay. She has basically kneecapped my pity party that I was all ready to have. See, like, we're not going there. And sure enough, I did the thought experiment. Again, I'm in my grief, right? And she pulled me out to do this thought experiment. And I thought, well, I've been touring recently, literally at that time, I was touring with Jonta Butler, Rochelle Farrell, and George Duke. And so we would come out on stage, bigger theaters, because of those names, and we would thrash, right? So we were doing all of that, and Johnson like lies, all that. At a certain moment, Jonathan just instinctively started, like in between songs, basically started playing, "Precious Lord, take my hand," right? George knew that, so he started playing, and then here comes, what do you call it? I just said it.
Rachel Farrell.
Joe Farrell, and we just got on into that hymn right there. Probably was 3 or 4 minutes. That was the sustained standing ovation of the night.
Wow.
Right. So we would be crazy not to then do the same thing the next night. That's how shows are built, by the way. Like you do something, you kind of throw something out there, and oh boy. And sure enough, God visited, man. And when God visits you, you got to be made of steel to not feel it, And sure enough, man, it's like in my head, I thought, I don't think there's anything out here like that. Like
No.
you get artists who are not necessarily Christians or
Right.
not gospel artists. I wasn't a gospel artist. But to put something out there as a Christian and say, these are my friends. We are gonna, as they used to say, each in his own way. We're gonna come in our own way
Right.
and present something that says, at the very core, we are spiritual beings and that we honor someone higher than us. Again, I'm worshiping Jesus, so Jonathan, but we just bring it out there, and man, and by so was Michelle at that time. Man, it ends up being this huge thing. Fast forward. Do I get a Grammy for anything I'd ever done on Columbia? No.
Yeah.
I got a Grammy for the Gospel According to Jazz series. And by the way, when I was then on Warner Brothers later on, actually we started making money. I wasn't making any money on Columbia Records.
Oh.
So I would say they dropped me into my destiny.
It's miraculous how that stuff works. It's somewhere you make a left turn thinking that you're not going anywhere, and all of a sudden you drive past the desert and there is that oasis which leads you to greater things.
Yeah.
Before we go on, I want to play some of your music, because granted I could play a whole bunch of music and this show would never end and you and I could talk forever. But here's Now Until Forever, which is a great tune, probably one of my favorite Kirk Whalum's tune on the Jazz Flyte Podcast.
Yeah.
have various paths. You've done a whole bunch of things, but there was a period of time when before you became, I'll say, rich and famous, you're planning clubs. And all of a sudden you get this phone call, and I'm not sure how it works, but you get this phone call, or this guy comes up to you and says, "Hey, my name's Bob James. Do you want to come tour with me?" What is that feeling like? All of a sudden this guy comes up who's got this illustrious career, and now he wants you to play with him. What are you feeling?
Yeah, that was, man, such a big deal. And I'll back up a little and, well, actually, that's not true. You're right. It was Bob. Opened a concert for him in Houston. It was just where we were living at the time, having gone to Texas Southern. And man, we were thrashing, man. I mean, my band was so tight because we were playing 6 and 7 nights a week. And we made, we were built, we had built up to quite an audience, but we didn't start there. And you're right, we were in a little club called Cody's. But the promoter who brought Bob James in, of course, would come out to hear us a lot. And so there we were. Bob James swears up and down that he said, yeah, when I walked out, while this opening act was on, because what I heard, this thunderous applause, he said, I had a feeling that the audience was peaking at that moment and that I wasn't going to be able to get them back to that point, with this band of all stars, but he's like, I'm not gonna never let that happen again. And so he hired, he said, I know how to nip this in the bud. I'll And so he hired me, and that was my first national touring, and then international within the same year. Booz Allen DC, Blue Note New York, Blue Note Tokyo, the Kosanikan Hall Tokyo, Osaka, just on and on. My head was still spinning from the call, and the same call for me to tour with him was also, can you record with Bob, his manager, Peter Paul. My wife made a joke about it. She said, wait a minute, it's Peter Paul, Bob James' manager. I'm like, how many people is that? Peter Paul, Bob James, nobody has a last name.
All
But
first names.
all first name, but I'll just say that the same thing happened with Larry Carlton. Like, so I'm touring with Bob James, and I get this call from Larry Carlton. He said, man, this is Larry Carlton. I'm like, okay. He said, I heard you on the radio out here in LA. And I pulled off the freeway, of course, no cell phones at that time, and used the call box. And I asked the people on the station, he had a relationship with it. So who was that? They're like, who? He's like, the sax player. He's like, that was Kirk Whalum. Can you get me in touch with him? And so next thing you know, I'm in LA, playing on this record. And then I ended up moving there, so it's like that's the way things tend to happen.
It is so funny. I think of, first of all, you do so many things, and we'll kind of get to that in a little while. But sometimes your work creates work. It is Bob
That's right.
James hears you and he wants you. Larry Carlton hears you and then he wants you. And I go to, so now you become a side man and you're playing on this song by this young girl named Whitney Houston. And she does a song called I Will Always Love You. And you have the sax solo. And everybody knew it was Whitney Houston, but everybody knew Kirk Whalum was playing the saxophone.
Some people know.
Everybody in my circle knew. But how does you have these enormous peaks, that being one of them, and you have taken it and continued that upward path? How, what's that struggle like? I mean, because you've got to be, don't get me wrong, I'm a Virgo. One of the Virgo characteristics is being a perfectionist. I don't claim to be a perfectionist. I claim to practice practical perfectionism. Everything I try to make it perfect. It's not always going to happen, but I try. What are you doing to maintain that high level?
Right, so really the Whitney gig, let me quickly mention that that was, that was all just, again, just the universe, the way it flows. I hired a bass player for one of my, I think it's my first solo gig in LA when we moved to LA in 1987. And I'm like, I didn't know many musicians out there personally. And so a friend of mine, drummer from Texas, Land Richards, recommended this bass player named Ricky Minor. And I called him, and he came out, played at Le Cafe in Woodland Hills. And you know what? I get a call from him the next day. He's, man, I had heard about you, and getting a chance to hear you live, he's like, I definitely think it would work if you're game to tour with Whitney Houston. I'm like, wait a minute, where is this coming? Like, I hired you. And I knew he was in her band, but I didn't know he had just gotten promoted to MD. And of course, people who know the name Ricky Minor, if even if they don't know his name, just look at the Grammys, the Oscars, the all of that. He's the guy who leads the band. He's the musical director to the stars. But at that time, he had been Whitney's bass player. And so, yeah, he offered me this beautiful gig, and I'm like, man, I'd be honored. And although I knew, by the way, Darrell, that the trajectory that I, the sort of little engine that could, the very slight incremental trajectory for my career path, I knew that was gonna be put on hold. And people tried to tell me, no, man, you're gonna be playing to hundreds of thousands of people. I said, yeah, but it's different people. Because, Whitney Houston's demographic was, from 11, to 35, and then she had some older folks who liked her. But that's where she sold tickets to. And man, it was true that the 7 years I played with her, I had to sort of claw my way back into this trajectory, which fortunately, as you said, I've been very, very grateful for the results. But it's hard won. There's a lot of competition out here, and you just have to, this new record is like, we just found out, like, it's like number four, and it's like, we've streamed like 5.5 million, streams, and on Epic Cool. And so this is the type of result that you don't, it's just not automatic,
Okay, before we continue, speaking of Epic Cool, and I want to talk about that title when we come back, because I think that title is a reflection of you, because dude, you are just cool. Let's listen to a track from Epic Cool, and this is called Pillow Talk on the Jazz Flyte Podcast. That is Pillow Talk from the new release from our guest on the Jazz Flyte podcast, Kirk Whalum. That is called Pillow Talk. Kirk, this title, there are some titles that reflect the musician that it is. I think if I looked up Epic Cool in the dictionary, there'd be a picture of you. I've always thought that there's something about your demeanor, delivery when you talk. I'm gonna say 80% of the songs that I've heard you play, there's just a coolness about you. There is a, I can put this on, I can go sit outside on it as it's dusk and the sun is rising, is going down, and I can just put this stuff on, and it's just like I can just sit here and be cool, sipping on a beverage, and just listen to it. How did you come up with the title?
So a friend of mine is the number one sportscaster in Texas, I believe, but for sure in San Antonio, Don Harris. We've been buddies for 40 years, but his dad was a Baptist preacher, so was mine, right? So all of that. And I send him stuff that I'm not supposed to send him, you know what I mean? Because it's not out yet, but I'm like, I need your opinion. And he sent back two words, man. When I sent him that song, the title track, he said, Epic Cool. It did not have a title until that moment. And so I gave him credit on the liner notes. But I do, though, in retrospect, I think it's a celebration of, like you say, you just had a birthday, man. We're in our mid-60s. And there's a certain gravitas and a kind of, the result of years of, you know, mistakes and victories and, you know, just general experience that, you know, if you name 10 young artists who we consider to be cool, you know, Burna Boy from Nigeria, you know, and what's the one from Puerto Rico? Big, huge artist, Bad Bunny. Mm-hmm. So there's a coolness, you know, like, wow, that's just amazing. But they don't have what we have in a sense, and that's that, no, we've been out here. And, you know, we kind of know we get a fork in the road. We have a little better chance of making the right decision because of all the wrong decisions.
Wrong decisions, yep.
So I think there's something to that, you know, not so much me, but, you know, our age group, man. I want to encourage my fellow, you know, 60-ers and, you know, folks in this age group, 70s, to say, man, I'm not trying to be young. You know, I know a lot of people dye their beards. You have a lovely beard, man. The gray is, you know, so, you know, it's so distinguished. And by the way, I'm a barber. I cut hair for homeless guys. But, you know, to say, you know, I'm not going to be dyeing my hair, man.
Right, I'm not. Yeah, I know that feeling oh so well.
Yeah, come on. I mean, epic cool, man. Just be you. And there's a certain something that's, it is what it is, you know.
Right. You mentioned the fact that you cut hair for homeless people. You do a lot of things. I don't want to get anything wrong. I don't want to misquote. Other than music, what else are you? I know there's some stuff online. There's some other things. I pulled up something and I'm like, he's involved in this? I didn't know that. Tell everybody what you're doing. And the other thing is, I'm always interested in how people manage their time. Yeah. With everything that you do, how do you manage your time?
Yeah, I am, you know, working on it, man. Like, you know, we all struggle, right, in one way or another. But I'll give an example. No social media after 10 p.m. sharp. Mm-hmm. But I don't go there. Once it's 10 p.m. rings, I'm shut that down, right? That's just one example. Mm-hmm. Man, I will get on there, you know, with the reels and everything. I'm like sitting there cracking up with somebody's cap.
Right.
But, you know, so the thing you mentioned about trying to serve alongside and hopefully serve folks who have been made poor, that's something that, again, I just look at my folks, man. You know, my dad was like, he was all about that, man. My mom too. And so I love that work. And it's not easy work all the time, because part of it is knowing that you're not going to fix everybody.
Right.
You got to get in there and say, well, where can I learn something from you? And you know, where can I serve you? And so those are things that I truly value. Donc je parle français. Je peux dire que si je n'étais pas musicien, je serais sûrement un professeur de français. So that would be one thing I would do if I wasn't a musician. I would teach French. O también yo puedo decir que uno de mis pasiones es estudiar y practicar el español. So that's another thing that I would do if I were not doing this. And it's a creative endeavor that involves a lot of memory work, which is great. You know, again, I highly recommend it for people in our age group, because you have to keep your mind sharp. So languages, that's the other thing I love doing. And I love riding my scooter.
Excuse me, say that last one again.
Yeah, man, I posted pictures of my scooter. I call it a Hardly Davidson. You know, so I'm around here in the neighborhood. I have this Italian helmet, you know, with the Italian flag on it.
Right.
Like, is that the old guy that lives down there? Okay. I have my dog in the back. You know, my puppy's, you know, he's 13, but he's a little guy. I have a little, you know, segment for him, this basket looking thing that he zips up. And yeah, we ride, man. And we go to the park and hang, you know.
You are an amazing gentleman on a lot of different levels. And I think that's why I enjoy our conversations, because there's a lot of layers to you, whether it be music or philosophy or faith or anything. But the biggest thing to me is, I'll go back to the epic cool. I've never Now, granted, I don't hear everything about you. I've never heard anything bad. It's always been positive. The stuff that you do outside of music is always positive. It is, you're just a good guy to follow. You are an example. And that brings me back to this show is a year and a half old. Not a year and a half, it's 13 months old. I've talked to other people who are saxophone players, and I've asked them about mentors. Who are your mentors? Who are your influences? And there's three names that come up, and one is yours. And I'm sure, I'm willing to bet that when you were growing up, that I don't know if Grover or Arnett or whoever sat down and talked to you and kind of brought you along. How does it feel for that role to change from being the
Minty.
to now being you're the mentor?
So that is, it's a heavy thing. Like, I think about the first time young artists call me OG. Or, like, oh, you're a legacy, and maestro. I have a student in Kenya. His name is Otieno, and also his nickname is Elvis. But he calls me maestro. But he translated from, into Swahili, right? It's like a word that I can't pronounce, but he just says master, right? He's typing, he say, "Master, are you going to be available?" Blah, blah, blah. And I have not gotten used to seeing that word. referring to master. That's crazy, right? But I get it in context. But you're right. It is a profound privilege to, hopefully impart something into the lives of these young musicians, man. It's just so precious because it's hard, man. This is a crazy life to choose. And, in America, much less Kenya, right? And he lives in Ocho, which is the poorest slum in that whole part of of Africa and Southeast Africa. So, man, I'm so grateful for these opportunities. And a lot of times I miss them, because I'm busy or I'm distracted with whatever thing. But I do want to be available when I can. And to try to, one of the things is my faith. Like, so you have to be very, very careful with that. But at the same time, you can't not be who you are.
Right, exactly.
Like my dad used to say, it's hard enough being who you is, much less who you ain't. So
I'm gonna quote
I
you
am,
on that from now on.
yeah, you'd be quoting KT, but so that's the thing is to try to live a life that points people to Christ. And as I think it was Saint Augustine said, when necessary, use words. Saint Augustine was black, by the way.
Deep is not a good description of you. It's just not.
My
It's not. It
wife has
is.
some words she can share with you that would help.
Do I really want to talk to her about these
No,
words?
you really don't.
Okay, I'm just checking just to make sure, because you never know.
No.
It's. I'm going to say this isn't necessarily the end of the show. You are a. I think we need more examples of men like you that we can see.
Right.
That doesn't happen a lot. We see. I'm gonna get myself in trouble. You watch on TV and it's always drugs and gangsters and this and that.
Yeah.
And I want to see more people that have an attitude like you do. That was a great thing about the show that I saw you do. There was an energy and it was a positive energy.
Yeah.
I want. Like I said, I just want more examples of men like you that we can see, that we can follow, that you can be my mentor for different things, and we can share different stories. And because, and I'll talk to you about something afterwards, but it is,
Oh, excuse me.
there's not enough. There's
Yeah.
not enough of you. There's not enough known about you. There's not enough of men like you for this to happen. I
Right.
want people to follow you. You have a social media presence,
Yes,
even
sir.
though you turn it off at 10 o'clock. There's still some people out there who will
On
follow
the
you.
dot.
What are some of the social media things that you're doing where our friends can follow you and get this wisdom that you have?
Thank you. So I'll turn that right back on you, Darrell. I mean, yes, You know, we need to show up, man.
Yes.
I mean, we need to show up and counteract some of the madness. And it's what God would have us do. And, you know, social media, people can always find me. Just type my name and you'll find me. Whatever format, KirkWhalum. You will not miss me, I promise. KirkWhalum.com is also a nice place to go. We have some lovely candles I'd like to sell you. It's t-shirt. But as far as social media, you know, it is the new town square. And so you have to try to be, you know, positive. And again, I'm going to always be, you know, hopefully representing the one I love and serve, and that's Jesus. But also, you know, to remain relevant and to stay in the conversation. I try not to be too political. It's rough, you know.
Yeah, I think I saw some of that.
Yeah, nowadays, you know, with the dogs and cats being eaten and all that. So, but what you do is you just try to hang in there and be a voice of kindness, number one. So that's super important. And then, yeah, a voice of reason and hopefully a voice of faith. And, you know, fun. I think, you know, being in our 60s, you know, there's sometimes we can get a little too serious. And so I just posted a picture a little while ago of my dog sitting out in the sun going like, you know what, I need me some sun time. So, yeah, but and I hate to dash, but I have to. But I want to make sure that, you know, man, how important it is what you do. And I'll follow you as you follow me. We'll be following each other.
Okay. All right. I know you got to go. Thank you for your time. I don't want this relationship to end.
Oh, sir.
I will. You'll be on. I'll send you Facebook stuff.
Yeah. You're stuck with me. And all that stuff. You're stuck with me. Just put it like that.
That's not a problem, sir. we will do our best to get your music out there. Ladies and gentlemen, he is Kirk Whalum. He is just, as the football players say now, he is him. I'll leave it at that. Go who?
Sorry about that, brother.
That's fine. I'm in Cleveland. We're horrible right now. All right. Thank you very much, Kirk. You've been listening to the Jazz Flyte Podcast. I greatly appreciate it. We'll talk to you next week. Thank you for tuning in to the Jazz Flyte Podcast. I hope you enjoy these stories and soulful melodies that grew through the doors of time. If you want to stay connected with the latest updates and episodes, don't forget to subscribe to my channel and hit the notification bell. Until next time, I'm Darrell Scott.